Hello, I'm Ushma Neill with the Journal of Clinical Investigation. Thank you for joining me for another in our series of Conversations with Giants in Medicine. I've been lucky enough to get an hour with physician and geneticist Dr. Funmi Olopade, who's the founding director of the Center for Clinical Cancer Genetics and Global Health at the University of Chicago. Dr. Olopade's research is focused on gaining a better understanding of the root causes and genomic basis of cancer in diverse populations. She's internationally renowned for her work in inherited cancer syndromes and for her clinical expertise in early detection and prevention of breast cancer in high-risk women. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
So I would love to start at the beginning. Can you tell me a little bit about what you were like as a child and your family?
Oh my goodness, I'm number five of six children. Very quiet and really inconsequential. Other than I have really wonderful parents and older siblings that took care of me.
So where did you grow up?
I grew up in Nigeria and actually started school in a very small town called Ijebu-Igbo. Although I was born in Abeokuta. Abeokuta, of course, is what's on my passport. And a lot of people would know Abeokuta because that's where the famous Wole Soyinka and the Ransom Kuti family also came from.
So what were the professions of your parents?
My father was a pastor. And the reason why I really loved education was because he would tell stories about there were only three professions that anyone could do in the former British colony, Nigeria. One is being a teacher, a pastor, or a doctor. And so he had the opportunity to go to school to be a teacher, but then he got into the missionary society and became a pastor. So in a way, I'm a missionary's daughter, and my mother is the missionary's wife. That's what they always said they were. So we went from one town to another in Nigeria.
Can you tell me a little bit about your schooling and what might have sparked any kind of an early interest in science?
You know, being a missionary meant we grew up in very small towns. And the focus was really to get people educated, number one, and to also really think about the world that's larger than yourself. So being born in Abeokuta, going to a very small town in Ijebu-Igbo, I remember that most of my early days were spent reading books and magazines and newspapers that came from out there. And so the first thing I read actually was a newspaper because my father always had the Time magazine, and then we would pour on Time magazine like it was the best thing every week when it got delivered. And then lots of really wonderful publications in post-colonial Africa. So that's what I enjoyed reading. And then of course, like everyone who grew up in a small town in Nigeria, you have to leave home to get the best education. So that's why I went to boarding school when I was 12.
I read some of the previous interviews you gave where you expressed that you had a real interest in physics. Where did that exposure or where did that come from?
Yeah, that's really in boarding school. We had really wonderful teachers. And what happens is you attract either arts or science very early on. And at least my classmates would tell me that from third form, I was really quite strong in mathematics and physics. Mathematics in particular, but my brother had already become sort of an engineer, and I was number five of six children, and my father really wanted a doctor badly. So I really just enjoyed math and physics. And so after O levels, which is really where you did more science I went to Queen's College in Lagos, and by that time my parents had gone to Lagos, and that's really where, for A levels, I did physics and dropped math for biology, because you could do physics, biology, and chemistry, or physics, math, and chemistry. But if you really wanted to be a doctor, you had to bring biology in. So I, you know, struggled in biology, but still did really well to be able to get to medical school.
So then tell me a little bit about medical school in terms of, did you have an idea then what maybe you would want to do with your medical education?
Yeah, well, you know, I think it's very interesting that, you know, Nigerian education was really special. I grew up really with the best of the best in Nigeria. Nigeria had money and we had found oil. So my high school, there were only 18 of us girls in an all-girls high school. And we had dedicated teachers who just came to prep, you know, every night to work problems with us. And I remember my textbook of physics, I was like, there's nothing else to do other than just work physics problems. And I did every night. And then, you know, I had a friend who was doing math instead of biology. So she was my buddy and we would just work math problems and physics problems all night long. In a girls' school, there was nothing else to do and do experiments. But, you know, it was because it was a special moment where, you know, 18 girls were put together to just think about 2 years of preparing to go to the university to study medicine.
Did you have any early inclinations? Like, I want to do cardiology or I want to do anesthesiology.
I ended up enjoying medicine and pathology the best. And, you know, Robin's textbook of pathology was so fun to read. And I had this habit of reading every book in medical school back to back, from cover to cover. And people thought that was nerdy, but I just enjoyed it. Physiology was great, and biochemistry. And so, but once we, you know, really finished the preclinical part of medicine, anatomy was a lot of, you know, memorization, so I really didn't like that. But once we got to the clinical years, it was so wonderful to be a doctor and to find that we didn't have all the answers. And that's when I started really thinking about what are those unsolved mysteries of medicine. And, you know, my pediatric rotation was fascinating because I, you know, we had some American trained, you know, pediatricians and diabetologists who did practice the American way, which was very different from the British way. And then I began really thinking about, you know, whether any of those specialties would, you know, interest me. So I left Nigeria really still very much eliminating things that I didn't like. Pathology I would have done, except I didn't like morbid anatomy. I just love talking to people, and I couldn't imagine having to do those autopsies, so that ruled out pathology. And then, so coming to America, I really wanted to do internal medicine, and I had role models who were in cardiology, so I wanted to be a cardiologist, actually, because it was challenging. You know, we had done one heart transplant during my rotating internship in a kid with rheumatic heart disease, and it was the first cardiac transplant. I was on that service. I worked hard, but unfortunately, the patient died, and I kept thinking, what a real futile exercise for us to spend so much time to save this child. But if the child had had penicillin, he would not have damaged his heart. So that really got me thinking about prevention, that, you know, had this child really had an opportunity to have penicillin, he would not have had his heart valve damaged. for us to then try to fix it and then spend maybe 90 days with this very sick child, and at the end of the day, he still died. So those were, you know, moments that sort of were transformative for me in thinking about how do I want to spend the rest of my life as a doctor, yeah.
So tell me a little bit about how you did happen to move to Chicago for your medical residency.
Yeah, well, you know, when you're young, all you want to do is just be fearless. and I think, you know, one of my habits in medical school is to really wake up to Voice of America. And during the Iran hostage, I loved Jimmy Carter. And I loved everything that was happening in America, because at 6 a.m. my alarm went off and it was Voice of America. And so with the oil embargo, with Nigeria having, you know, received lots of money from having found oil in Nigeria, we all went to medical school for free, and the government gave us money to just do whatever we wanted with it. So investing in that education allowed us to discover the world. My brother was already in graduate school at Stanford, and, you know, and we all were in medical school with more money than we could use because we were studying. And so during the summer, that meant you could go anywhere. And so that's when, you know, one summer in 79, I decided to use my bursary to travel. And discovering America was really huge because I then loved it. I thought everything was big in America.
Well, that is true. So how did you pick Chicago and the program at Cook County?
This is American medicine. It's very technology driven. You know, I tried to interview and, you know, different places. In fact, since my brother was at Stanford, I thought San Francisco General, Stanford and all that. But, you know, those programs didn't take international graduates. And it was clear that, you know, they were not going to take me, but, you know, just getting information from other places, they talked about, you know, maybe you can start at a, you know, public hospital. And so I just mapped out where all the public hospitals were. And Chicago in the summer, of course, it's beautiful. We had a friend in Chicago, and he was willing to, you know, welcome us. And so I landed in Chicago, I think the day after Labor Day. There were still all the summer activities. And of course, by that time, I think we didn't know what caused AIDS, but people were dying, and we didn't know why they were dying, and the public hospitals were short-staffed. And so the minute I walked into Cook County Hospital, they gave me a job. It was like, any one body standing, just come on in. We were short-staffed. But I had a very nice interview, and so I was determined to come back to America, because I was thinking, you know, if I get a job, fine, maybe I'll stay, but, you know, if not, I'll come back and really apply. I hadn't even done all my exams, but I was checking it out. So once I knew that I could, you know, come back to a job, then I, you know, I had done the visa qualifying exam. So when I passed that, I was like, okay, now I've passed that. Now comes time to think about leaving, because they were already very interested in sponsoring me for a visa.
How did you decide to do a fellowship at the University of Chicago?
Yeah, it was not a direct course because, you know, coming from a very strong clinical background, having left Nigeria because I was really looking to do research, I was disappointed that at County, we were so busy. We were so understaffed. And so I ended up doing another year of chief residency. And during that year, I had time to reflect on what I wanted to do again. You know, I had done cardiology, but during my time at County, it became clear that, you know, there was so much cancer in the community, and these patients suffered so much to come to me. from different parts of the city. But those who came and who got treated for cancer, they actually got better. I didn't see that in Nigeria, right? Everyone in Nigeria died, and there was so much stigma around cancer. I had really compassionate residents and mentors and, attendants at County. They were committed. And from that moment on, I was like, I think I want to be an oncologist. And so I interviewed around the first time around. I think I got one or two interviews. My husband and I were trying to synchronize. So I spent another year as chief resident. And during that year, I was looking to what I did in medical school, using autopsies to learn, because we didn't have a way to diagnose. But if somebody died and you didn't know why they died, then we did an autopsy and we learned so much pathology. So I took it upon myself to see whether I would be able to consent black people to do autopsies. And I found that during that year, we got our autopsy rate to almost 70% or more, because everyone I asked said, sure. And I was like, okay, this actually can be something. If I could go to a place where I can do research, this would be phenomenal, because then people are not gonna die from cancer, because we will figure it out. And so that's why, of course, reading about the great Generali and the chromosomes in leukemia and lymphoma, and rotating with some of the U of C residents. We had a small hospital in Chicago, a community hospital, Michael Reese, where, you could have, residents from County and residents from U of C sort of learning about urban health in this small place. And when I was there, it dawned on me that, U of C residents actually don't have two heads. I'm just as smart, or maybe smarter than them. The difference was they had the opportunity to do research. And from that moment on, I was like, I'm going to apply to U of C. And if I get in, I'm going to not waste the opportunity. I'm just going to immerse myself in research because I have one shot at it.
So let's talk a little bit about your fellowship and the research you did with Janet Rowley. Was this, do you think, maybe part of the dawn of your interest in genetics?
Nobody goes to University of Chicago without learning or knowing about Janet Rowley. And she was approachable and she made herself available. And so everyone, the program director said, go talk to all this wonderful scientists. And Lainey Fuchs was a female, lots of really strong female scientists when I got there. But Janet was like the trailblazer, and you only needed to be in a room with her and you want to be like her. And so, I remember interviewing 12, scientists to see, because we had a training, and I'm the director of our training program now, because our T32 training program was actually about training medical oncologists basic science. And so you got to go to a lab paid for by the government. And I was like, why won't you do that? Right? I've been training in clinical medicine all my life. I knew every differential diagnosis because of my very strong clinical training from Nigeria. But the one thing that was missing was just being lost in the lab. And so she made it easier for us to work in the lab. Her team, her research associates, as the scientists in her lab, but most importantly, the technicians in the lab. You have to be humble to come as a physician and then just get in the lab and say you want to start. And it became clear that the pecking order was be humble, and maybe somebody will teach you how to put things together. So I was lucky that she had a lab that was welcoming and supported late bloomers like me.
You were clearly very successful in the lab, finding a tumor suppressor on chromosome 9, and so good that they invited you to stay on the faculty. So can you talk a little bit about what that transition was like?
Well, I mean, if you know the University of Chicago, and if you know our tradition, you don't stay in the same place where you trained, right? But I was really very lucky because, you know, strategically, I went to the lab knowing that the tradition was that you really want to be independent of your mentor. And I was really looking to make sure whatever I took out of University of Chicago, I could take it anywhere. So that's why having the protected time to do another 3 years of training beyond my clinical year was really very important to me. And I think sometimes when I think about what were those years like, they were years where I really wasn't running around doing a lot of clinical work. I could plan my experiments. By this time I had 3 children. I could plan my experiments around, you know, my children, when I had to pick them up at school. You know, the children could come to the lab and just hang out until we all went home. And so I tell people that actually being in the lab worked for my personal family balance at that time. The children, cooperated because they went to University of Chicago lab school. They were lab rats, so they were used to, you know, after school coming to the lab. And then my colleagues in the fellows room all were very good at babysitting my children while I finished an experiment in the lab. But I think it was because Dr. Rowley really set the tone, and the genetics was coming, right? We knew cytogenetics. She was very adamant that I didn't learn cytogenetics, that I should do molecular biology. So it was a different teacher and a different set of classes. So I knew molecular biology, and she knew cytogenetics. So I had one on her. And then we collaborated. You know, she really got me to curate the chromosome aberrations in solid tumors. And so if you write a paper or you do anything with Janet, she was very detail-oriented. And as we collaborated on doing this, you know, catalog of chromosomes in leukemia, she became the editor with Felix Middleman. Then I realized that we didn't really have much on solid tumors. You couldn't grow them in culture, and you didn't know nearly enough about them. So the few cell lines that were available for solid tumors, they were melanoma, you know, head and neck and lung cancer. So I studied all of those cancers, but leukemia, because I knew I couldn't compete with Dr. Rowley and all the other great hematologists at the University of Chicago. And then that turned out to be really a good strategy for me. I remember the haha moment was 1996. Right? We got BRCA1 in 94, my P16 was 1994, and then my husband and I went back, and I remember going to my medical school and trying to tell them about, oh boy, this great discovery of BRCA1. And everybody was like, what? This is highfalutin, it doesn't apply to us. And they immediately turned to my husband to tell them about asthma and about, you know, tuberculosis, because it was a lung doctor. And I was saying to this medical student, because they invited us as alums to have, you know, a conversation with them, I was like, boy, you are not intellectually curious, and I'm going to show you. Right? And I'm going to show you. And so it so happens that nothing had changed since I left. You know, I left in 1983, and they were still teaching them common things occur commonly. You know, if you see a mass, it's tuberculosis until proven otherwise. And this, by now, I was really overqualified to practice in Nigeria. So the only thing I could do is to do research in Nigeria. And, you know, they tell you once your children are 9 years old and you haven't gone back to your country, you're not going back ever. So, but I was fortunate to have had the Department of Defense, the Era of Hope, asked for anyone who had ideas on what to do about breast cancer epidemic to write a proposal. And, you know, Mary, you know, we had published our first paper on extended African-American families. They didn't have what at that time everyone was thinking were Jewish mutations. They had just heterogeneous mutations. You had to sequence the whole thing to find the mutations. And we had a lot of variants of unknown significance. So the minute you do the experiment and you see variants of unknown significance, boom, that means you have to figure it out. You have to continue to dig deeper. And that's really why we were able to then really, you know, link up with those who were, you know, studying methylation, people who were looking at, you know, by that time, Chuck Peru had, you know, looked at basal-like breast cancer.
Well, so speaking of that, you have been a vocal proponent of cancer genetic testing for all, and even started a company, Cancer IQ, related to this. Where do you think we stand with more access to that kind of testing, and especially in lower resourced environments?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the lessons I learned, because I was in the clinic, first of all, my patients, just whether they were black or white, they signed the same informed consent. They wanted us to find the gene. They wanted to be part of the solution. Some of them lived, some of them died. But I made a promise that I was going to continue to do this work. And if we figure it out, we'll bring their family back in, we'll get a biobank going, and we're going to find good in this work. And they trusted me because I actually believed what I was telling them, that prevention is better than cure. That in medical school, which is the best example of why you can have innovation come in different places, those people in Nigeria didn't have anything, so they don't want to ever come to the hospital. And so we spent all of our medical school talking about prevention is better than cure. And so preventive and social medicine was sort of fundamental to being a doctor in Nigeria. And then I come to America and it's the reverse. Oh, let's bring everybody to the hospital. Let's do more and more drugs. Let's escalate bone marrow transplant, this. And it didn't, to me, as a young person coming into the field, it just didn't seem that it made any sense. So that's why I really wanted to make sure we could have biomarker-informed clinical trial. And when you look at the heterogeneity of who lived, who survived, a lot of my patients actually survived because they had access to clinical trials. And so I really wanted to make sure that we could really bring the culture of research in.
If you could not have been a physician or a scientist, what other profession do you think would have kept you as engaged?
I really did think about it a lot. One is I love debates. And I remember I also love acting and just being, you know, present. So I wanted to be a lawyer because law as a career would really allow me to be able to do debates. But then I was like, no, the science and the math could just get me focused. And I loved that. And then I thought, maybe I'll go to divinity school after I've done with my medicine. But then I realized, no. I believed too much in science and technology to go to divinity school. And so, yes, I love being a doctor. And so many times I've thought, you know, should I pick one or the other? But, you know, I've been fortunate to have an esteemed position in society. And the fact that my patients trust me, and the fact that I don't know nearly enough to help every patient, just keeps me going.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for joining me today. It was such a pleasure getting to hear a little bit more about you and your motivations.